Hi everyone, my name is Jessica. I'm one of the undergraduate advisors here at the School of Computer Science. Today in this video, we're going to talk about checklists, how to fill out your checklists, and which checklist to choose. And also, we're going to quickly explore the undergraduate calendar. So first things first, we're going to go to cs.uwaterloo.ca/checklists. If you scroll down a little bit here, you'll find the different programs available here at the School of Computer Science. We also have a section here regarding breath and death, and we'll go into that in a little bit more detail in a bit. And there's also a section on how to complete your checklist here. So if you click on one of the expandable boxes, you'll notice that there are several different years here and a variety of different checklists as well. The year in which you choose will depend on when you start in the Faculty of Math. So if you start in the Faculty of Math as a math student, starting fall 17, winter 18, or spring 18, then you want to choose the 17-18 calendar year. You can also choose any calendar year after the year that you've started. So if you started fall 17 or winter 18 or spring 18, you can use 2021 calendar as well if you choose to for whatever reason. You'll notice that there are checklists for each of these for each program and specialization. So let's get started with the BCS program first. So here's the checklist for the Bachelor's of Computer Science, and you'll notice that you have to complete 40 unique courses or 20 units. Your 40 courses are outlined here on the checklist, and there you'll notice as well that they're split into required courses and your electives. For your required courses, they include CS courses and also your math courses. In both cases, you might notice that there is a funny square bracket. So what that means is that the funny square bracket could have a middle digit of either 1, 3, or 4. So you take CS1, 1, 5, then that's okay to fulfill this requirement here. You take CS1, 3, 5, then that's okay to fill this checkbox here. And again, if you take CS1, 4, 5, that's okay to fill this checkbox here. You'll notice that it's a similar case with CS136 or 146 that can be used to fulfill this checkbox. As you progress in your academic career here with us in CS, you'll notice that you'll have more flexibility with the type of upper year courses you can take. So for your upper year courses, it's just a range of courses. And we have a lot of courses available in CS that goes off into like some really awesome topics. So for instance, if you decide to take CS349 as an example, then that's okay because it'll fulfill this requirement here. If you decide to take something like CS446, then that's okay because it'll fulfill this requirement here. You'll notice for your very last checkbox, you actually have extra flexibility as to the course that you take compared to these five courses. So for your last checkbox for your CS requirement, you'll notice that you can take a course that can go as high as CS498. You could take CS499T, CS6XX, or 7XX, which are graduate level courses, CO487, or STATS 440. So those are all your CS requirements. All your math requirements are listed here. Again, with the square bracket, you can either take Math 135 or 145 to meet this requirement here. For your electives are further subdivided into non-math elective units and additional elective units. For your non-math electives, that means that you have to take courses that aren't offered by the Faculty of Math. So that includes your communications courses and also your breath and depth. Your breath and depth course is a requirement for the BCS, and you have to take 1.0 units of humanities, 1.0 units of social science, 1.5 units of pure science, and 1.5 units of pure or applied sciences. So you might have the question of, oh, if I take so-and-so course, what category does it fall under? Is it like a humanities or social science? So to answer that question, you can either click here for your breadth and depth, and it'll take you to this page. Or if you return to the checklist, the CS checklist page, and you scroll by the checklist and go to breadth and depth, You can find a variety of different breadth and depth links. And so long as you take the correct calendar year relative to the checklist that you've chosen, then you go ahead and continue on with breadth and depth. So for your breadth and depth requirements, you'll notice that all the courses available at your Waterloo is noted here. Its subject is noted here, its description, and whether and which category it falls under, if it falls under any. So for something like AFM, you'll notice that it'll fall under social sciences. For something like AHS, you'll notice that it'll fall under applied science. For something like AcSci, because it's a math course, it doesn't actually fall under any of the categories here because it's a math course and not a non-math course. If I scroll further down to biology, you'll notice that it'll actually fulfill either your pure science or your applied science category. What that means is that biology can either fulfill this section or this section of your breadth requirements, but the one course in biology can't fulfill both. So if you take a biology course and you want to use it towards your pure science requirement, you will still have to take another pure or applied science course to fulfill the remaining requirement. Moving on to your depth, there are two ways to fulfill your depth requirement. One of them is to take three courses with the same subject, and at least one of them needs to be 300 level or higher. So a popular route that some students would take would be Econ 101, Econ 102, and Econ 344. Because you have taken Econ 344 and that's a 300 level course or higher, then that's okay to fulfill your degree requirement here, or your depth requirement. When it comes to the other way you can fulfill your depth requirement, you just need to have three courses that fulfill a prerequisite chain of three. The prerequisite chain of three is when you take course C, you have to take course A. Sorry, when you take course C, you have to take course B. And for you to take course B, you have to take course A. So an example of that would be Physics 111, Physics 112, and Physics 224. So for you to take Physics 224, you have to take Physics 112. You would take Physics 112, you have to take Physics 111 beforehand. So that forms a prerequisite chain of three. So for your additional elective units, this section could be anything you want. So if you wanted to take more math courses, more CS courses, or anything else really for that matter, you can use that to fulfill this requirement here. This is particularly helpful if you wanted to do a minor in math, as an example, where you still have to fulfill all your requirements here, but if you wanted to take a minor in math, you could in stats as an example, then you could fill up this section here with your stats courses. In addition to your breadth and depth being part of some constraints that you have to be aware of, there are also additional constraints here. One that I want to point out is the co-op requirements. If you're in co-op, you have to make sure that you're also meeting your co-op requirements. But if you're not in co-op, you could just go ahead and ignore this section as well. Scrolling down to the last section of the checklist, we do have a disclaimer where this checklist is really handy, but it's not a substitute for official degree regulations. So if we happen to have an error or an issue in the checklist, then the university calendar always takes precedence. So in other words, the university calendar is always correct. And I'll quickly show you how the university calendar looks like. So the university calendar looks like this. It notes all the programs offered here in CS, and also its specializations, and also the minors as well. And so when it comes to the BCS as an example, you note that everything in the undergraduate calendar is exactly the same as what's noted in the checklist, but just in a different way. That being said, though, it is a little bit hard to read sometimes the undergraduate calendar, which is part of the reason why we made the checklist. But as I mentioned before, if we did make an error in the checklist, then the undergraduate calendar takes precedence. If you're concerned about your checklist, or if you're concerned about whether or not you're filling out your checklist correctly, you can always send us a completed checklist, and we can take a look at it to just double check that you're on track and that there's no surprises at the end. That being said, though, even if we look at it, we are human. If we do make a mistake, is still ultimately up to the student to ensure that they've met their degree requirements. So again, if you do have any questions about checklists, how to make sure that you are meeting your degree requirements, or if you are unsure about filling out your checklist or what courses work for your degree requirements, then feel free to send us an email at csadvisor@uwaterloo.ca. Thank you.